Hey, Dean Yeager.
You may be right. I may be crazy. But it just may be a lunatic you're looking for. Turn out the lights. Don't try to save me. You may be wrong for all I know, but you may be right.
Back. It's Joe. We called it top five random, but we're not really rating these as our five best. We're just going to call it random five. And basically, these are movies of actors that doesn't quite make either the top four or top fives that we've done, or actors that just aren't enough that we're not going to do a top five.
Right. Yeah.
So we're just going to call it random five. So it's a list of five films that we really enjoy that may not quite make the other list.
Right.
So,
In this case, a little bit different on one of them we're going to start out with is one that he's going to bring up one that I haven't seen. I'm going to bring up one that he hasn't seen.
Sounds good.
Is that that's cool?
Yeah.
You want to go ahead and start this out?
You want me to start it?
Yeah, go ahead.
Wow. There's only two videos I get to start. I'm a little excited. We're going to start out with a film that came out in 1972, starred Gene Hackman, called The Poseidon Adventure.
The Poseidon Adventure. Yes, I'm a big fan of Gene Hackman. I have not seen the film.
I highly recommend seeing that. They remade it in like 2003 or 4 with Kurt Russell.
I saw that one.
That one wasn't that good.
I was not impressed.
No, it was more high tech because of the ship and being able to see it. But no, the acting in this one, and it was great. And you felt like you were in the ship. I mean, basically the ship turns upside down and it's still floating, but it's sinking. So you got to get out before it sinks. Just phenomenal acting, and you put them in a ship, and I think they actually put a ship upside down and put the actors in it.
Yeah.
But yeah, just a heck of a film. I'm not great with actors' names, and I know Leslie Nielsen's in it. He plays the ship's captain, and there's a few other ones in there that I've seen before, but I'm just not that good with names.
I'm pretty sure I understand that Ernest Borgnine.
Yes, there you go. Yes.
Love Borgnine.
Boy,
man.
Him and Borgnine and Hackman going back and forth. They fight
for
a lot.
For that alone, man.
That is great. You know, both of them are in their heydays.
Yeah,
It is great. Yeah, so Poseidon Adventure, highly recommend to see that.
Yeah, I'm going to check that out. I'm a big fan. I'll go with one. It was early 90s. I think it was 90, 91. 91, maybe. It was New Jack City.
Yeah, I haven't seen it. I know it's, what, Wesley Snipes?
Wesley Snipes, yeah. He plays, I'm trying to remember the name of his character now. Nino Brown, I think, was his name.
Okay.
Nino Brown. And he's a drug lord in New York City. And he's got a crew. And some of them are familiar faces, and he's, you know, he's caught, because he's grown so big, he's got the attention of three cops get together to take him down in the form of Ice-T.
Oh, boy.
Judd Nelson.
All right.
And who was he? Oh, Mario Van Peebles.
Now that one I don't know.
Yeah, son of Melvin Van Peebles.
Okay.
But, yeah, they team up to take him down. Man, dude, it is great, man. I love that film.
I need to see it. I know you've talked about it over the years. So
yeah, a very, very young Chris Rock is in it. Probably 19 years old, maybe.
Wow. Yeah.
Great film, and it's also, you know, a warning, too.
Okay.
You know? But, yeah, I love that movie.
Okay. I got one for you. So I Married an Axe Murderer. Mike Myers. Oh, come on, man. That is great.
Yeah, it's
great comedy, man. Nothing heavy, nothing dirty. It's just funny.
I
forget the guy who's his friend who's a cop. He's been in several movies. It's not in the theatrical version, but he played Al Capone in Road to Perdition. It was a small part, but it was cut from the theatrical version.
Anthony LaPaglia.
Yes.
Yeah,
he plays his friend, and...
Yeah.
They basically, you know, Mike Myers meets someone and he falls in love and they're going to get married. Well, they think she's an axe murderer. They call her Mrs. X or whatever. And so his friend's trying to get up to, you know, this cottage where they're at. And he's just playing in this pilot. And the guy's like, "So you ever done this before?" He said, "Oh, yeah, I do this all the time. I've never done it at night, though."
I saw it once with a friend of mine.
It's great. Mike Myers... He plays the dad, too. Oh, my gosh.
Yeah, I remember.
Move your head.
I want to give a shout out to a mutual friend of ours, Jared. He introduced me to the film. I am not a... Well, all right, let me qualify this.
You don't like good movies is what it is.
That's not true.
I beg to differ.
That's not true.
We watched a lot of filth.
Listen, that aside, I'm not a huge Mike Myers fan. I loved him. Probably my favorite film of his was Wayne's World. Not the segue,
that's why
but
I
that.
Didn't bring it in.
But yeah, so I mean, and then
you need to watch it again.
Maybe. I know Nancy Travis is in it.
Yep.
And Amanda. Oh gosh, man, Amanda Plummer. I don't.
Well, that's the point. She's supposed to get on your nerves.
Yeah, she does.
Exactly. Yep.
Well, she does it affect.
That's
Loki,
the beauty so of
then
it.
Then it's a success.
All right.
Okay. All right. So how about Karate Kid?
Love Karate Kid. First, the original one, right?
Yes.
Not the remake.
Yes.
Oh man, love Karate Kid.
Yeah.
Like the whole. The third one drops off pretty far, but I like the whole series, yeah. But the first one, I mean, you can relate, you know?
Yep.
You know, being bullied in school, like, especially when we went to school, that was a normal thing. Now it's no bullying, which is great, because going to school worrying about being bullied sucked.
Yep.
Not that I was bullied a lot. After, like, sixth grade, you know, I kind of shot up in height, and nobody really messed with me, but no, I
did the crazy eyes on some guy, and he had me up against the wall. It was... All right, you know, but yeah,
no, but yeah, great, you know,
yeah, love. Ralph Macchio, man,
oh,
dude,
come on,
Elizabeth Shue,
yes,
and of course, man, Pat Morita, dude,
Pat Morita's great, even he was from Happy Days,
he was, man,
oh,
he didn't know
man.
Anything about karate,
no,
nothing of that, you know, I found, I don't know if you watched it. I don't know if I sent it to you, but there was a really great interview with him about how we got on board with Karate Kid. He was in between projects, and he was looking at just dropping out of the industry and having to maybe work, you know, just, you know, regular jobs, whatever. And yeah, it's really cool on YouTube. But yeah, and then of course your favorite and mine. Martin Cove.
No, that's your favorite.
Martin Cove. Cobra Kai, man.
That's your favorite.
Sweep the leg. You have a problem with that? The leg. Sweep it.
Got it.
Yeah, sorry. Okay, go ahead.
No, I love it. It's great.
I need to check that show out, man.
Which show?
The Cobra Kai show.
Yeah, the Cobra Kai show. I watched like the first 5 episodes of season 1. I think season 3 is about to come out because Netflix took over it. It was on YouTube. But Netflix took it over.
And Martin Cove comes back, man.
He does?
Yeah, he does, dude.
Cobra I know Kai. He's doing those commercials now with those apps that like run the business or whatever. And he's something like, not being able to handle my business made me a little crazy or something.
Steel justice, man.
Oh, man.
But yeah, so Karate Kid.
All right, well, my number three, well, it's not even number three. The next one on the list is Reign of Fire.
Reign of Fire, man.
Yes, Christian Bale, Matthew McConaughey.
Yep.
Yeah, it was a movie that I really didn't know anything about. It was like 4 or 5 of us friends. We went to the theater. What do we want to see? And somebody, I think, pointed out, he said, let's watch Reign of Fire. I said, what the hell is that? And no idea, but, oh, great. You know, it's what, based, I guess, on the future. Or I guess it's modern time, and these dragons are woken up.
Yeah, somewhere in Europe, I can't remember if it was France or Spain, they find a cave and they awaken a dragon.
And then it just burns the whole planet.
Yeah,
and it's just now there's just communities, and Christian Bale, I guess, kind of runs this one community.
Right,
and they're just trying to fight starvation. You know, they grow these crops, they wait. Basically, borderline starvation for these things to grow so they can get the seed so they can replant again for next year.
Right.
It's a very tough living, and Matthew McConaughey shows up from, you know, America, and he's got this great plan of taking them out, and, you know, it's just really great.
I remember when that came out. I don't know if I saw it in the theaters or not. It was, what, 98?
No, it was longer than that. It was like 2002,
2003. Was it really?
Yeah.
Okay. I remember reading some back then. They used to have, I don't know if they sell them, but publications, Starlog and stuff, on sci-fi fantasy films. And I was pretty excited for it. I don't remember if I saw it in the theater, but I will say when I did see it, I was like, I was I was really impressed. I loved it. But then I was disappointed, too, because there was so much potential for it. Sort of came out of nowhere. It wasn't part of a existing franchise, which so many films back then were. It was starting something. I thought, wow, well, they could really go...
They could go, yeah. They could have, like, maybe cut it a little short.
Yeah.
And they did, like, three or four of them. But you got to applaud them. I mean, they said, this is what we're going to do, and that's it.
And that was it, yeah. And left me wanting more. I was never satisfied, I guess. But I loved the movie. It was great.
Yeah, great one.
Yeah. I'm going to go with In the Line of Fire, Wolfgang Petersen film.
Clint Eastwood, right?
Yes.
Oh, man. And John Malkovich.
John Malkovich. Rene Russo as the other FBI.
Oh, man. Yeah, there's what? It's a plot to kill the president.
Yeah.
And Clint Eastwood, you know, he's been around. I think he was a Secret Service agent. In the film, he was a Secret Service agent when Kennedy was assassinated.
Right, that's right.
And he's like, you know, one foot out the door as far as retirement, but he's kind of sucked back in, and he actually goes back into the service. And yeah, Malkovich just, you know, blows it out of the water. You know, he's helping Eastwood a little bit, like giving him bits of information and stuff. And I love that. What's that scene where he's like, and what's the address? Oh, you want the address, huh? He's like, sorry, I want to keep you in the game, but I'm not going to throw it to you.
Yeah,
but oh, it's great. Yeah, I really enjoyed it. You actually had me watch it. I think it was on our movie list.
One of those films, for some reason or another, we've talked about this before, films that, especially when you're younger, you see dozens of times. You don't get tired of seeing it, and it could be any film. I've seen Crimson Tide like that with Gene Hackman a bunch of times.
Yeah, that's another good one.
But yeah, definitely In the Line of Fire I've seen, and they said, well, same guy who directed Das Boot, Air Force One, bunch of other films, great classic films.
That's a good one.
Yeah, I highly recommend it.
That's a really good one.
Yeah.
Here's the one, and it's an actor I don't think you're a huge fan of, but man, did he knock it out of the park in dramatic fashion. Rain Over Me.
Okay, yeah. Yeah, I saw Rain Over Me. Yeah.
That was great. Yeah. You know, basically, you know, I think it's based on a true story. It's definitely over true events. You know, a guy loses his family in the September 11th attacks and doesn't really know how to cope with the grieving process. And John Cheadle's in it, is his friend. Oh, man. You know, Adam Sandler just shows off his acting range.
I remember seeing it once.
I have to agree with you. I only saw it once, too. But it had such an effect on me. I still remember it, and I really need to revisit it again.
I think so, too. Because I remember watching, I thought it was pretty good. It really wasn't, I guess it didn't have the same effect on me as it did you, but I need to revisit it. Maybe Sandler or someone we could do later on. There's only a handful of his movies that I really enjoy.
Yeah.
But yeah, it was pretty good. And Don Cheadle, as always, the guy... really, and in this case, the movie was good, but even if the movie's not that great, the guy always brings it to the table.
Oh, yeah.
And it brings it to the next level.
You know, we're hoping we got, you know, our special guest. We're supposed to get together and do a top five Adam Sandler, because I know you're not a huge Sandler fan, but I definitely want to bring this up because it definitely had an effect on me. So, yeah.
Yeah. Okay. I think from there, I'm going to go with, what number are we on now?
I think we got, what, about two more we're going to bring?
Two more?
Yeah.
Let me bring up one, probably not a lot of our viewers may be familiar with this, but Disorganized Crime.
Oh, I love that.
Yeah.
Oh, man, that's a definitely one that's, it doesn't run with the pack.
It's the same guy who, and I fault me for this, but I don't remember the director's name, the same guy who directed Stakeout,
yeah. Boy, you know, it's got a slapstick comedy to it. It's got a serious tone to it. It's got
A crime film mixed in.
Oh my god!
You know, and in any other film, this might
be
just
a train
collapsed.
Wreck.
Yeah, yeah.
It doesn't work. But the fact that it doesn't work makes it work.
Makes it work, and especially because of the writing and the cast.
And the cast, man. To get a cast together like that. And the way it starts out, you're like, this is a seriously toned film. It's They're going to rob a bank is basically the gist of it. And just the actors they put together. Well, then all this stuff starts to unfold. And it's basically a comedy. Oh, my gosh.
And I will say it's probably a good thing, like a disclaimer for anyone who wants to see it. these aren't actors who even back in the, it came out in 89, with the exception of one, Ed O'Neill.
Ed O'Neill, as Al Bundy.
The rest of the cast weren't necessarily like household brand Tom Cruise.
They were B actors. They were supporting
character actors. Yes. That's who they have. Fred Gwynne, Herman Munster.
Herman Munster, man.
Ruben Blades, Lou Diamond Phillips, even down the line.
Yeah.
Corbin Burnson.
I see that one. I don't remember it.
He was Salazar, the one they were trying to actually hook up with plan the crime. But
Major League.
Yeah, Major League. Yeah. You know, it just works. Even though it doesn't work, it works on so many levels.
Yeah, it was very good. Now, if you set out to look for this, it's not that easy to find. So you're going to have to go on a little bit of a scavenger hunt. But yeah, definitely.
Yeah, it's and just the last thing to say is, you know, basically what we're saying is that it's sort of like you and I have talked about before, Tommy, The Burbs. It's one of those films that, for some reason or another, just hit it off with a certain generation.
And it's got kind of a cult following. But then again, I don't know a lot of people that know this.
This is true. Winston, I bet you've seen this.
All right.
My buddy Winston.
I don't know if you do this on purpose, but I know the last random ones. I like to bring one out that's kind of a dark horse. Okay. And since this is my last one on this list, Vision Quest, Matthew Modine.
Okay, yeah, Vision Quest.
I love Vision Quest. That was Matthew Modine's first movie. And it's a great kind of coming-of-age film. You know, he's saying, like, he turned 18, you know, and he wasn't ready for it. But, you know, he wants to make his mark. It's his last year of school. He's 18. And it's about, you know, wrestling. And the gist of it is that he's in high weight class. He wants to drop down to, you know, the most competitive, where there's a guy who hasn't lost in like 3 years, like just dominates the class. Well, he wants to go down and wrestle him. And that's basically it is. And, you know, it's kind of a coming of age, you know, he's, you know, dealing with stuff, you know, you're getting, you know, you're becoming a teenager, you're about to graduate and all that stuff. It's just great. You know, just great, clean comedy.
When you had told me about this, because when we started doing that list of films we wanted to check out, whether it be films that we had seen and want to see again, or films neither one of us had seen, or so on and so forth, I'd never seen, I think I'd heard of it, and you told, and before you told me the synopsis of the film, what it was about, you said the name Vision Quest, and I thought, what is this, like, he has a vision of the future, or he's
it is kind of a weird name for the film, yeah.
Yeah, and I thought, what is this about, and then you told me it's about, like, high school wrestling. Yeah. I'm like, that's strange. But yeah, it was great. You said, what was it, the coach in that?
The coach was in the thing.
The thing, red hair, like reddish. Yeah, curly hair. Yeah.
Then you have Brian Cox.
As the father. Yeah.
And there's another actor. I know you know who it is, but I'm blanking what else he's been in. The cook.
Yes.
The one he had. Oh, he has a great scene.
Yeah.
You know, it's the big match. It's going to be the big match. And
right.
He goes to see him before his match, Matthew Modine, and he's like, you called in sick. And he's like, yeah, it's your big match. He's like, well, it's just 6 minutes. And he goes into this whole thing. He's like, it's not about the 6 minutes. It's what happens in those 6 minutes. But, and then the soundtrack is great. All these 80s bands. You got Journey, Sammy Hagar.
Yeah.
Oh, man. I forget. There's one that escapes me. I don't.
Whitesnake.
No, it's not Whitesnake. I think it's Dokken. But don't hold me on that. But no, I remember my parents being a fan of it the first time I saw it. And then when you're kind of coming up in that age, you just kind of relate to it a little bit.
Well, and there's a lot of films, you know, in every generation, every decade has them. But, you know, in the 80s and so on and so forth, a lot of films that were inspiring to young people and whatnot for that generation inspired them to move forward or to try to achieve certain things or whatever. And that was one that I wasn't really familiar with, and I credit you with showing me that. I appreciate it. It was a great film. Matthew Modine, man.
It's where you got to start.
Yeah. Let me consult my...
your list here?
Yeah, because last one I actually forgot.
Oh, boy.
So do we have some elevator music we can play or something? I mean, I don't know what. Oh, yeah.
You're really messing this up.
Sorry. Save the Best for Last.
All right.
Universal Soldier.
I disagree. It's not the best. The first one's decent. It is okay. I like the concept. It's okay.
Didn't Michael Bay do the first one, or Emmerich, or somebody?
Now that I don't know, because I've only seen it once.
Oh man, it's great.
Take a line
dude.
From you.
You had Van Damme, dude. Listen, okay. What it boils down to is,
here we go.
it's like a super soldier program. Soldiers who were killed in battle and they're revived. And, you know, Dolph Lundgren and Jean-Claude Van Damme.
Just because Dolph Lundgren's in the damn thing doesn't make it a great film.
I disagree.
I know you do. It doesn't make you right.
Edo Ross plays, I think he plays the chair. Edo Ross is in it. And then you had a few others playing the other soldiers. They had like minor roles. I think Tiny Lister Jr., who we just lost here recently, was one of them.
Michael Dudikoff?
No.
Sorry, Dudikoff. I tried.
But yeah, as a side note, I did want to pay tribute to him, Tiny Lister Jr. We just lost him the other day. He was, you know, young, great actor. And, but yeah, he played a minor role in that. And basically, if no one's, well, for the people who haven't seen, I'm sure most of the people in this world have seen this movie as big as it is.
Not that big.
It has so many billions of fans.
Sure.
Listen. So they're super soldiers. They go up against each other because Van Damme, you know, begins to remember certain things, has flashbacks, grows a conscience. He's like, well, I can't be doing this. And he starts fighting against Dolph Lundgren.
Right? Oh, I'm all ears, soldier. Are you done?
No, hold a second. So the first movie is classic, right? Classic sci-fi. The second one.
I thought we were just talking about the first one.
Right. Well, yeah, but we can segue a little. Let's chase around.
We're not segueing nothing here. The first one is decent. After that, they're crap.
No, actually, the third one was pretty good. It had the Mad Dog.
I thought it had Bill Goldberg in it.
No, that was the second one. That was rough, man. No, that's trash. Third one's great, man. It's great. Okay with the first one.
All right.
Remember, Lundgren comes back and goes, there's something I wanted to tell you.
I didn't see the third one, I don't think.
Oh, you get it. Check it out. It's great.
Yeah, I'll get right on there. Yeah. All right. There's five random films. Let us know if there was any in there that you liked, any of that you disliked. Probably a lot on his list. But anyway, you know, give us some ideas, you know. If we want us to keep doing this, or, you know, if there's an actor in there that we named a movie, you know, I think we'll get to a Clint Eastwood top five eventually. I mean, we have to. Yeah. His acting and directing, you know. But Matthew Modine is kind of a small sample. He only did, you know, a few. They were good films. I mean, then he showed up in Stranger Things.
He did, yeah.
Yeah. But anyway, till next time, we'll see you later. Wait a minute. Stop. Good night. Good luck.
Good night and good luck.